afternoon. It is good to see you all here on this Holy Wednesday version of our Wednesday Eucharist service. Glad to have you all here. Welcome guests and visitors who can be here with us. Also our online viewers. We hope that you'll come back and worship again with us here soon at St. Stephen's. Thoughts and prayers continue for Mr. Paul Fatman and also the family of Crystal Burgess upon the death of her grandmother, Doris Wicker. So let's continue to keep them in our thoughts and prayers in the coming days and weeks. For our announcements portion, just a reminder that this is Holy Wednesday. We do not have Wednesday Night Live tonight, so there will be no dinner and no Wednesday Night Live programming, and there's no worship this evening. But there is our second performance of The Living Last Supper, and if you weren't able to be there on Sunday, do yourself a favor and come for what is an exquisite performance and something that's very, very meaningful anytime, but especially during this Holy Week. So we hope that you'll come tonight at 7 p.m. in the gym and come and be a part of that Living Last Supper performance. That will be the last performance of that for this year. So look forward to having a good group there tonight. And this also is the Great 3 Days Eve. So tomorrow, Maundy Thursday, starts the Great 3 Days, and we will have services tomorrow on Maundy Thursday at 12:30, 5:30, and 7. Remember, those 5:30 services are focused more on children and families. So you may come, but it's going to be a much more basic service than you're probably used to if you're used to the 12:30 or 7 o'clock. But it is a wonderful service for those with children and families. And so again, 12:30, 5:30. And 7 tomorrow. And tomorrow we will look at Thou Shalt Not Bear False Witness as we look at our Ten Commandments. And then on Good Friday, again, services at 12:30, 5:30, and 7, with that 5:30 service being for family and children. And our Ten Commandment for that day will be Thou Shalt Not Covet. Then we'll have our Easter extravaganza on Saturday at 10 a.m. in the gym. All things candy and snacks and eggs and bunnies and all the sorts. So we hope that you'll come and be a part of that. And then Easter Sunday, we have 3 services, 6:30, 8:30, and 11, with an Easter breakfast at 7 a.m. in the social hall. So we hope that you will come and join us on all of these worship experiences during this most important and holy of weeks, culminating with our Easter celebrations. Regular reminders, offering can go in the offering plate there in the narthex, or you can go on our Giblify app or go on our website. Communion, those of you at home, if you'd go ahead and gather your elements. We do have prepackaged elements available in the narthex for those that would like one. And then for those of you coming forward for communion, you'll do so one side at a time, beginning pulpit side first. So any other announcements? Seeing none, then we'll begin service with our prelude.
Crown him.
Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, imploring Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a troubled and penitent sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities with which I have offended you and for which I justly deserve your punishment. But I am sorry for them and repent of them and pray for your boundless mercy for the sake of the suffering and death of your Son, Jesus Christ. Be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Forgive my sins. Give me your Holy Spirit for the amendment of my sinful life, and bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Almighty God, in His mercy, has given His Son to die for us, and for His sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by His authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray together. Almighty and ever-living God, you hate nothing you have made, and you forgive the sins of all who are penitent. Create in us new and honest hearts, so that truly repenting of our sins, we may obtain from you, the God of all mercy, full pardon and forgiveness, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Today we turn to God's holy word found in Matthew. It's chapter 7. Hear these words. "And everything do to others as you would have them do to you, for this is the law and the prophets. Enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the road is easy that leads to destruction, and there are many who take it. For the gate is narrow and the road is hard that leads to life, and there are few who find it. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Are grapes gathered from thorns or figs or thistles? In the same way, every good tree bears good fruit, but the bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire, and thus you will know them by their fruits." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So grace and peace be yours through Christ our Lord. Amen. One way to interpret today's commandment, "You shall not steal," which is what we're going through this Lenten time, is to think about boundaries. You know, where is the line between right and wrong? Where do my freedoms begin to impede your freedom? You know, for example, you wouldn't take somebody, say you're waiting in line at a restaurant because it's popular and there's a lot of people there, and while you're there, you just happen to walk over to somebody's table who's already been served and just pick up a piece of their food and start eating it while you're waiting. You probably wouldn't do that. They go, "Hey, that's my food. Get away from here." That might be stealing. When Cindy and I were in seminary, one Saturday morning, I got up to go to the store or something, got in her car. It was an old Toyota Tercel, and I went to turn the key and nothing. I was trying to figure out what was happening. When I opened the hood, somebody had come to our car that night, opened the hood, and clipped the two wires to the battery and took the battery out. There was no battery in the car. They definitely stole my battery. If I go to the Masters next month and I set up a chair at the particular hole that I want to see them coming in on the back nine, and then I go out and watch a couple people that I like to watch and then come back to my chair a little bit later and somebody takes my spot, is that stealing? I don't know. If you're waiting for someone to back out of a a parking spot at a busy shopping place. And before you can move in, somebody else quickly skirts in there and takes the spot before you do. Is that stealing? There's a great scene in the movie Fried Green Tomatoes where the one older character is waiting for this person. She's being so kind, and while she does that, these two younger girls come take the spot, and they just laugh at her and say, "We're younger and we're faster than you," or something like that. And in the end, she kind of gets her own revenge because she's older and has more insurance. And all of this not to even mention cyber theft or intellectual property. So there's a lot out there today. And in fact, I was telling Pastor Jason, this sermon stole a lot of my time this week to think about some of the things about stealing. But it does remind me of the phrase, there are only two people in the world, they're givers and they're takers. So is there some proverbial stop sign to indicate when giving ends and taking begins? And where is that stop sign? So here's one of my thoughts this week. If I were to say the name Karl Marx, what would come to mind? Probably communism. Karl Marx was born in Rhineland of Germany. He was baptized as a Christian at the age of 6, and he was born into a Jewish home. But as a teenager, he even had some very beautiful things to say about Jesus. Later, he met this person named Friedrich Engels, and afterwards, he ended up writing the Communist Manifesto. Now, Marx is considered to be the father of communism, and Marx believed that the root of all evil was ownership, the possession of property. So let's figure out a way to live in society where nobody owned anything except the government. He believed that if people would give all of their property, all of their possessions to the state would bring about equality and justice and equity, and everything would just be hunky-dory, peachy keen. And he was right, perhaps, in saying that economics plays a great part in the history of nations. He was wrong, though, in thinking that it was the pivotal point upon which all nations and classes struggle. He was also a little naive, I think, to think poverty in the hands of the state government would bring about justice and equity and utopia. I mean, after all, the people in state are human beings, and we're all prone to sin. But Karl Marx believed that the possessions of private property would end, indeed, the root of all evil. And I think it's interesting how God includes in the Ten Commandments, "Thou shalt not steal," which kind of implies that you have possessions to own to be stolen from to begin with. So these already got a premise that's a little bit strange. God isn't opposed to people owning something. Just don't steal it from somebody else. And as we continue to review commandments this Lent, how can this commandment be broken in our own lives? Because all of God's commandments aren't about do this and you're going to get in trouble. It's about how can we live in relationship with one another and with the kind of love God calls us to live. So first of all, these things I think can be broken by what you take. Taking something that belongs to somebody else, like money or possessions or ideas even. I read about a hotel in New York City that said in 1 year's time it lost 38,000 spoons. 335 silver coffee pots, 15,000 finger bowls, and 100 Bibles. You'd like to think it'd be the other way around with the Bibles. I also read somewhere that a high percentage of insurance claims are really fraudulent. And when it comes time to fill out one of those forms, there's something within people that seems to snap, and they think, you know, this is my chance to make a buck. I think I'll add a zero to that amount to see if I can get something back. I read about a Chicago area university that had a problem with books being stolen from the library, and eventually, through this scheme to find this person, they discovered it was an honor student that had 70 books on their shelf in their dorm room. So there's a saying that goes, unless education is also combined with regeneration of the heart, it only makes you craftier. It doesn't matter what you know, it's how you use what you know. And what is your heart there? We also know the commandment can be broken by a mindset or even your behavior. You know, employers who don't pay an adequate wage to their employees, it doesn't seem very fair, does it? And if you go into the Bible, James chapter 5 says this, "Behold, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which kept you back by fraud, are crying out against you. And the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord." Something about fairness. On the other side of the coin, employees can steal from employers by not giving the proper effort that's required in a day's work. We know some people, or sometimes we might slack off from time to time. customers can be taken advantage of with price gouging. One of my favorite stories was when my mom and dad's home in Somerville, South Carolina, was besieged by Hurricane Hugo back in the late 80s. And so that next week, there was a plethora of people coming through neighborhoods to help you get these trees off your house if you would only pay a little bit of money. So we had this one group of guys come in, and they told my dad, "Oh, I see that tree is over there. We'll cut it down for you. It'll only be $200. And my dad thought about it and said, "You know, that's all right. I think I'll hold on to my money." About 5 minutes later, there was a group of church guys that just came around in an old beat-up truck. And they said, "It looks like that tree is kind of dangerous. Can we take it down for you?" And then when they were done, they sawed it up and put it right there and just went on to the next house for nothing. So you got to be careful out there. Business owners can be taken advantage of through price tag switching called swapping tags or shoplifting. There's a song I've heard on the radio several times called Popping Tags, where you pop those little plastic things off the bottom so you can take them out the door without getting the indicator light to go off that said you took it. Perhaps you borrow, but you don't get back. I hate to say this, but when I moved here about a year and a half ago, I was cleaning up my office at the other place, and I found a book that I had borrowed from somebody 10 years earlier. I pray that I don't go to the hot place for that. The Bible says in Psalm 37, the wicked borrows but does not return again. And this also applies to being dishonest on your income tax form. Sorry to say that we're hitting that time of year. The book of Malachi, we read this. Will anybody rob God? If you're robbing me, but you say, "How are we robbing you, God?" And I say, "In your tithes and offerings," because you're the second person who's come to me today to make something right, is what God says. God wants our attention. And that's what we talked about in Remember the Sabbath and Keep It Holy. So one more story. I read a story about when revival came to Western Canada and swept over hundreds of churches in the early 70s. Apparently this was a phenomenon. So one of the early indications with that it was a movement of God was when people, after getting the good news of God in their lives during this revival time, started to return things to stores that they had stolen over the years. They were making up for time that they had cheated from their employers. They were also sending money to the government in hopes that they wouldn't, if they got caught, would be forgiven. The officials at the borders between Canada and the United States knew that there was some kind of revival going on because many people went to the border officials and told them that they lied when they crossed the border and they just wanted to make it right. That would be the phrase they heard over and over again. They said they brought goods over, they didn't declare them to pay the taxes, and so it was just a burden on their minds. That's what happens, it said, when people really get right with God. One person shared how they had gone through the supermarket and on the bottom of their cart was this 99-cent bag of potatoes. You ever put stuff on your cart, you forget to bring it up so that they can ring it up, and then when you go out the store, cashier didn't see the potatoes, they get to the car and they said, "You know, I'm not going to lug all this stuff back. 99 cents isn't going to kill anybody," so they just stick it in the car and they forgot about it. Well, she let that supermarket cart go, and years later she said, one day the Holy Spirit just nudged her and said, something like, "Sack of potatoes, remember that sack of potatoes." And so she made an appointment with the manager of the store and went back to the store and told the owner what had happened and wanted to repay and blah, blah, blah. And the owner just looked at them and said, "You know, this must be my lucky day because you're the second person who's come to me today to make something right." And she said, "There's some kind of a spiritual awakening going on in our country." The point of all this is that all of us are guilty of stealing in one way, shape, or form. And I find it interesting that when Jesus died on the cross, he was even nailed between two sinners. Jesus' death on the cross was for all of us because none of us is able to keep all of the commandments without help, without the gift of the Spirit in us that keeps us on the road of righteousness. And none of us is able to live flawlessly on the basis of our own works. We're all kind of built this way. Even Karl Marx, who sought utopia, literally paradise, through reducing possessions. But I think he forgot to realize that the key to paradise would be not in the lack of possessions, but in the lack of being possessed by God. And I think that's the difference for all of us. By God, the fruit of the Spirit grows in us, and then we are able to love God and neighbor. And this fruit of God's Holy Spirit in us and through us reveals who we are as God's people. So this is what Luther wrote about the seventh commandment, that we are to fear and love God so that we neither take our neighbor's money or property nor acquire them by using shoddy merchandise or crooked deals, but instead help them to improve and protect their property and income. So something happens when the Spirit is in us. And instead of thinking about giving and taking, we think more about giving. As the Spirit grows in us, we become possessed by a God who comes down from heaven, dies on a cross to live in our hearts. And we see and we act and live then in the best possible light, as Martin Luther would say. And then we stop. We stop the taking and we begin to start the giving. So in this reflection of our lesson for today, I think we are made to be that good tree which bears the good fruit. So today during Holy Week, we hear how Jesus died to possess those who have this inclination to steal. Last week, we heard about how he died to possess those who had an inclination to commit adultery. Tomorrow and Friday, we'll hear about the death of Jesus to possess those who are inclined to covet or to slander neighbor. See, God seeks to possess all of our lives so that we can stop the sinning which steals life and start living by faith and love which gives life. In fact, our Lenten series on commandments is meant to lift us up by living the faith and then to honor God of grace who goes to the cross so that we can be free. Free to live a new life in the Spirit, free to discern false prophets who come in sheep's clothing but inwardly are ravenous wolves, as we heard today. That we're free to not feel the need to steal, that we're filled with God's grace and commanding goodness. Let us pray. Our gracious God, we thank you for your commandments, so help us this Lent to return to you with all of our heart. Forgive us our sin, fill us and form us with your Spirit of life, and forge us with faith and fervor to love you and neighbor as we're also to love ourselves. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thine forever.
and should I fainting be, Lord, let me never, never outlive my love to Thee. Lord, be my consolation, shield me when I must die. Remind me of Thy passion when my last hour draws nigh. These eyes faith receiving from Thee shall never.
Let us now profess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He has seated at the right hand of the Father, and He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. The night in which He was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to His disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, He took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. You may be seated. For those with prepackaged elements and those joining us online, the body and blood of Christ given and shed for you. Amen.
I can feel
Rise. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.